Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Mr. TARDIS, and today we're going to be talking about the brand new Doctor Who companion played by John Bishop. We're going to be talking about Dan. We're going to be talking about who he is, what to expect, and what to make of adding another older guy to the TARDIS team, and what it all means. Let's talk about it. Hey folks, so let's dive right into today's topic. Glasses, no glasses. Glasses, no glasses. These are just blue light ones. I don't need them to see or anything. At the end of the 2021 New Year's Day special, Revolution of the Daleks, we got a teaser trailer announcing brand new companion Dan, played by Liverpudlian comedian John Bishop. Firstly, for the teaser itself, it's not a lot, but I'm glad that we got something. Obviously, due to scheduling, gone are the days when you'd have a Christmas special, and then there'd be a minute-long trailer for a series broadcast 4 months later. With Series 13 not expected to broadcast until around September-October time, I knew that we wouldn't get much, but we knew that they had been filming for a few weeks, so I'm glad that they showcased something. But it was a headline grabber, the announcement being the number one most viewed news story on BBC News that day. Morning shows talked about it. I even had my dad, who doesn't even watch Doctor Who, texting me saying that he'd heard the news. So in terms of an announcement making a splash, it absolutely succeeded. So, who is John Bishop? Well, it's possible that those outside of the UK will have no idea who he is, and that's okay, but he is a stand-up comedian, he's in his mid-50s, he had a career change in his 30s to pursue comedy, and he's now become a staple of the UK comedy scene. He's always appearing on panel shows, he's always touring, he's always working, and you can watch many of his stand-up shows online, you can watch some of them on Amazon Prime, but you can also watch select clips on YouTube. I recommend John Bishop on Fridges, you can watch that clip on YouTube, I put a link to it in the doobly-doo.
I just got an iPod. It holds 24,000 songs. I've got 6 CDs.
And if you've heard the guy speak, you'll know that his accent is thick. Now, I do expect BBC America to get some angry emails and angry tweets asking Nate, demanding for subtitles, and I'm only half joking there. But his accent is part of his charm, it's part of his persona, which leads us to his acting career. Honestly, he hasn't done that much, the odd TV drama here, the odd film there. In preparation for this video, I watched the Ken Loach film Root Irish. I thought, you know, since Ken Loach is so good at getting really great dramatic performances out of comedians, I mean, just look at Dave Johns in I, Daniel Blake, that it would be a worthwhile thing to watch. Nope, waste of time. John Bishop is barely in the movie. In fact, the inciting incident of the film is the character's funeral. His character only has about a minute of screen time in the film, and even then it's just shaky cam footage of when the character was alive, so yeah, that was a bit of a waste of time on my part. Good film, there's a waterboarding scene, which apparently they did for real, can't abide by that, nope, it's no good. However, I have heard that the real showcase of his acting talent is the ITV drama Fearless, which broadcast in 2017. So I'll try and check that out in the near future, but either way, his role as Dan is easily the most high-profile scripted role that he's done to date. But strangely though, I'm already seeing some skepticism from the Doctor Who community about casting a full-time comedian in a companion role. Honestly, I really thought that after so much time that fans would have gotten so much smarter and learned from their mistakes, but nope. It seems that after Catherine Tate, Matt Lucas, Bradley Walsh, people are still saying that comedians or personalities can't be a companion in Doctor Who. And listen, I know it can be hard to change your mind, I really do. Heck, I remember hating the announcement that Matt Lucas would be returning in Series 10. I even made a comment in an old video about it.
Seriously, a creative team who think that bringing back Nardole as a recurring character is a creative team who have no idea how to read their viewership.
And I was proven wrong. I love being proven wrong because it means I've got more to learn, and he was one of the best parts in Doctor Who Series 10. We need to stop doing this, folks, okay? Even people who generally dislike the current run at least tend to agree that Bradley Walsh, actor but also game show host and reality TV star, is one of the best parts of it. I think the most comparable actor, at least in terms of career progression, would be Catherine Tate, who was at the peak of her career when she became a regular in Series 4. They had to move heaven and earth to get Catherine Tate involved because, you know, she was still touring, she was still working, but they made it work, and she proved herself to be a truly fierce, dramatic talent. So let's bring it back to Dan. What do we know about Dan? Well, the teaser showed that he's from Liverpool, current day Liverpool, I'm going to assume, and he works as some kind of a handyman, you know, maybe a plumber, a builder, maintenance guy, who knows. What we do know, though, is that he is slated to appear in the first episode of Series 13, which appears to be an invasion of Earth by the Sontarans. We've seen some on-location footage showing Liverpoolians chasing Sontarans around with frying pans. We also know that the actors Paul Broughton and Sue Murphy will be playing Dan's parents. Paul's Spotlight page says that he'll be playing a character called Neville in an episode directed by Jamie Stone. That's presumably Jamie Magnus Stone, who directed Spyfall Part 1, Praxeus, Ascension of the Cybermen, and The Timeless Children. In the initial press statement from the BBC, Chris Chibnall says, "Oh, we've had to keep this one secret for a long, long time. Our conversation started with John even before the pandemic hit. The character of Dan was built for him, and it's a joy to have him aboard the TARDIS." Bishop, like everybody else who's got a role in Chris Chibnall, was Doctor Who, had to audition for the role, and Chibnall said in Doctor Who magazine, but this is a Radio Times write-up of it, that John and his character bring a different flavour and a different humour to the show. We're loving him in the rushes and having him as part of the production. John Bishop is currently doing a bit of a promotional tour for his Great British Bake Off Stand Up to Cancer special, which starts next week, as well as Zoom-hosted events, and he said that he originally spoke to Chibnall around Christmas 2019 when he was asked if he'd like to be involved. However, he had a tour lined up and he couldn't commit at the time. And then, you know, everything happened. The tour got cancelled, filming for Series 13 was pushed back from an April start to October, so we could get involved. This is according to John Bishop. That last bit was pretty interesting. I didn't know that until I read this, that Series 13 was meant to start filming way earlier in the year, but got pushed back due to the pandemic, understandably. Now, what do I think? Firstly, I think it's a really good sign for the show as a whole that it can land one of Britain's biggest comedians, even if it is for a truncated 8-episode run. Of course, that is if John does only stay for the one series. Obviously, there are some concerns that he might be there to replace Bradley Walsh and just fill in the gap of the older, working-class white guy, which, on the surface, I can understand the trepidation. I mean, if we meet Dan in Series 13 and he's like, "Oh, I used to drive trains, I'm a leukemia survivor, have you met my great-grandson? Son Brian Minmare and my late wife Chase?" Yeah, if that happens, we've got an issue here. Who knows, he could have even been a last-minute replacement for Captain Jack Harkness. Who knows if we're going to have a pansexual Dan from Liverpool. However, I still do think that there is a chance for a fun dynamic shake-up. Firstly, from that preview clip, we know that Dan is still working. He's got parents because they've been cast in his debut episode, and he's from busy Liverpool instead of quiet Sheffield. I think that says a lot in terms of potentially differentiating himself from Graham. I also like the idea on paper of Yaz being the veteran companion, the character being maybe 25 to 30 years Dan's junior, and it might be a fun dynamic in terms of just breaking Dan into time and space, but let's talk about Yaz. Now, if your reaction to John Bishop's casting was just a disappointed sigh, because like me, you wanted to see what the series would be like with a much smaller main cast, or if you wanted to have an all-female TARDIS team for the first time in the show's history, then you know what, I'm right there with you. However, if it went beyond a disappointed sigh and became anger, or you were lashing out at John Bishop on his Twitter or his Instagram, just no. Firstly, John Bishop has nothing to do with this creatively. He didn't create the character, he didn't conjure him up. Your options were never the 13th Doctor and Yaz, or the 13th Doctor, Yaz and Dan. It was always going to be the latter, just maybe with a different name at the end. As for the all-female TARDIS team, to be fair, that sounds like a bit of a cop-out response, but we've never even had an all-male TARDIS team. We've come close. Stories like Evil of the Daleks, Legopolis, Planet of Fire, they all started with boys in the TARDIS with their arm wrestling and their grunting, whatever it is that men do inside small wooden boxes, I obviously wouldn't know. But we've never had a same-sex pairing for a full story. But I get it, you wanted an all-female TARDIS team, or you wanted Jodie and Mandip to shine and get priority, I get it. But I do feel that those getting emotionally invested in that pairing to the extent where you're just yelling at John Bishop for being another straight white guy on TV, presuming that Dan is straight, we don't know, but let's just say that he is straight, just for the sake of argument, not only does that feel like a deliberately reductionist take, I mean, diversity means more than just skin colour, it means more than just gender. But those same people, I feel like they are the same people who, in a year's time, will be sharing funny GIFs, they'll be quoting his best lines, they'll be making memes for whatever the equivalent of... You're doing it, mate! Whatever his equivalent version of that is. And also, just because Dan is on board doesn't mean you can't stop shipping the Doctor and Yaz. It ain't for me, but you do you. That is a fan thing first and foremost, and Dan's inclusion isn't going to stop that. Like I said earlier, part of me really wishes that it was just Jodie and Mandip, because that four-person TARDIS team in Series 11 and Series 12 was really limiting the show as a whole. It became indicative of most of Series 12's problems. Overcrowdedness. And that feeling would stay the same even if it wasn't John Bishop being cast, if it was a woman of colour, or just another woman generally. It would still be the same. People online are decrying the casting, a minority, but still some people are doing it, because he's a straight white man. And honestly, it's not a good look. It doesn't help anyone, it makes you look bad, it's short-sighted, you look exclusionary, when the whole idea of the TARDIS is that, on paper, there should be space for all, whether they be ginger temps from Chiswick, bald cyborgs from space, bus drivers from Sheffield, or handymen from Liverpool. However, I will end the video with this. My biggest issue with this casting is that we are dealing with yet another human from contemporary Earth. Yes, he's from Liverpool, and yes, he's an older guy, which, apart from Graham, is a slight breakaway from the formula, but since 2005, the show has been adamant about having a human companion from the present day, with the exception of Nardole. It was a good strategy in 2005 to break a new generation of fans into the show, but even as far back as 2012, 2013, it was really starting to feel repetitive and stale, let alone nearly 10 years later. The biggest show in the world right now is about an Eastern European witch and her robot husband. I think that Doctor Who viewers can... I think they're able to adapt to a non-human companion, or even a companion from just a different time period. It doesn't even have to be the far-off future, it could just be the near future, or even just the near past, like having a companion from the 1980s. The Eighth Doctor travelled with Mary Shelley, the Second Doctor travelled with a Highlander and a Victorian at the same time, the Fourth Doctor travelled with an alien warrior, the Fifth Doctor travelled with someone who tried to assassinate him. Just mix it up. If you're gonna have so many stories set on present-day Earth, around three quarters of them at this point, it would be nice to be able to view our familiar planet through a fresh set of eyes. That being said, the John Bishop casting might get my dad to watch Series 13 of Doctor Who, and you know what, I'm willing to bet he won't be the only newly interested person. I'll say this, John Bishop's casting is good for the show, its audience, and its longevity. Whether or not Dan is a success, that remains to be seen. Hey folks, thank you so much for watching this discussion video. Please let me know what you think of the format, you know, new webcam, new monitors and everything, new setup. Please let me know if you want me to do more videos like this in the future. At time of recording this video, we are only like a couple of subscribers, like single digits away from 20,000 subscribers. So if you haven't subscribed, firstly, be sure to subscribe to the official Mr. TARDIS YouTube channel. But also, I'm going to be doing a 20k subscriber live stream in the near future, following my social medias for updates and all of that. The community tab on YouTube, just keep an eye on all that. Now, I want to thank all of my patrons who have been helping to keep the lights on here and Mr. TARDIS. I want to give a particular shout out to Matthew Perry, Anne Neubauer, James Raby, Dean Jones, Daniel Davis, Flabu, Dylan Whitaker, Andrew Blewett, Raven Woods, Rebecca Hill, Callum Baird, The Brit Sniper, Joseph Adams, Palex, Katie Maxwell, Luna Day, Shazeb Mangi, Zachary Taylor, aka Mario Fanboy 15, Samuel Brooks, Darius, Zarby 555, Nathaniel Holden, and Dan Morrison. So thank you so much to all of my patrons. If you want to become a patron, get your name in the credits, get access to early videos, then please consider becoming a patron. It massively helps to support me and it massively helps me out. And I'll see you folks next time. I just finished recording. I started eating a bloody breakfast biscuit. And I go, and we've hit 20,000. We've hit 20,000 subscribers. We did it. We did it. 20,003 subscribers. Stay tuned for details about the 20k subscriber live stream. I'll do that over the next couple of days. 20,000 subscribers. Thank you so much. Thank you so much to all of you. End video.